It's kind of a bail.
I'm well done. I'm hard. It's still more to go through, but I think I've gotten most of it.
Yeah, I think after you have.
Okay.
Okay, let's continue. So now I want to develop these aspects in a few more in a simple model EFT, which allows to study many of these things in analytical form. So the toy model is really very simple. So we have bosons, a light field, which is called small phi, and a heavy field, which is called capital phi, with a mass n, which is a small mass, and capital M is a large mass. And just for to be precise, so this kinetic term, d phi squared mass terms, with a boson, so m squared over 2 times the field squared for both light and heavy field. And then we just take a simple interaction of phi squared times phi, and this matters. Doesn't matter, the coupling constant g. And so we assume that the small mass is much smaller, much less than the big mass, and we want to integrate out the heavy fields and just consider processes for energies of momentum of the typical scale of the light mass. So we want to write an effective field theory which is only the light degrees of freedom anymore. And so first look at phi phi scattering. So phi phi scatters to phi phi at tree level. So this diagram, so the black lines or the thin lines are the light fields, and the fat red lines are the heavy fields. So we have these S-channel, T and U-channel exchanges, and you can write that down easily. You get this tree amplitude is G square over all these two couplings over m square minus s is the propagator in this diagram, g square over m square minus t is propagator in this diagram, and g square over m square minus u in this diagram, and these are the standard Mandelstam variables. S is just p1 plus p2 squared, t is p1 minus p3 squared, and u is p1 minus p4 squared. These are standard, and you square them, you get s plus t plus u is 4m squared. And since we, this might look strange, but we constrain ourselves now to a situation where the capital field, this m is independent out there, we do not see the capital M here anymore. So we let m go to infinity, and then this will emerge naturally. So let m go to infinity, you see that the tree graphs, if you look at this and you Taylor expand the momenta, you see you get a 3g g square over m square from the terms which have no s, t, and u. Then you get a 4g square m square over m square, this is one of the suppressed terms, you see one power of small m over capital M. And then you get terms which g square over m6, which have s square, t square, u square, and so on. So you see that at low energies, the subsequent terms here are suppressed by energies, which are s, t, or u, squared divided by m squared, because s is s squared. And what we now want really to fight is an effective Lagrangian with the light fields only, which at low energies gives you exactly the same scattering amplitude, the same physics. So we want to formulate an effective Lagrangian of light fields only, which leads to the same physics, and now I will show how to do that. Now, of course, the effective Lagrangian has an infinite power of terms. So there's a kinetic term, there's a mass term, nothing changed. Then there's, of course, the term which goes like phi 4. This is contact term with autoderivatives, which has a constant c0. Then you can have a phi square and then another squared phi square. So there are two derivatives, because these are bosons and there's parity invariance. You can only have even powers of the derivatives. So you have a term like c1 phi square, another squared phi square. Then if c2, you can square this lambda, which has more derivatives, and so on. And so these are the low energy constants, C0, C1, C2, and all the terms you can write down. So the tree level scattering you can work out quite easily. So you have just calculated these diagrams. From this interaction, you get a 24 C0 squared. This is just a combinatorial factor from all the ways you can contract the fields. four factorials, otherwise you would just very clearly write coupling constant over four factorial for five four terms to get one here. So that's 24 C0, then you get from C1, you get 32 M squared C1, and then you get from this term 8 C2 S plus T plus V squared. And now you assume you want that the three-level CU, three-level amplitude, which I showed you in the previous experiment, is the same as the three-level amplitude of the effective CU, and that is called matching. So that is here the amplitude you have calculated before, and this you now want to match to this. And then you can read off relations, so you see these terms which had no ST and U, where this combination here is the same as this combination from the previous amplitude. Then C2 was this. This is essentially the factor you see here. This is our C2, or that S squared plus T plus U squared, and so on. So in this, you cannot separate C0 and C1. This is an artifact of this model. It is not general. This is just an artifact of this coupling used here. So in principle, you could probably drop C1 for the later discussion, but never mind.
Why doesn't C1 induce any momentum dependence?
No, because when you use the because you can use the equation of motion to completely get rid of this.
Even when like you have grad acting on one phi and dotted into grad acting on another phi?
Yeah, because of the identities, you can do a partial integration and then go back to the equations of motion because of the simple interaction.
Ah, okay.
This is an artifact for this particular system. This is not in general, but for this particular model it holds. Because in the point is because it is linear in this heavy field, so there's this phi square here and linear phi square, so in general it's not more. Mm-hmm. But here you can show that using a equation of motion can get rid of this term completely. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is matching, so this is a model artifact, but you see how you get, so now you have to expect this logic first in terms of the parameters of the initials. So you see the G appears, the small mass appears, and the heavy mass appears.
So there's three terms.
And so at three levels, these are equivalent. You get the same scattering amplitude. But the question is beyond, because if you remember that this model, which I wrote down, is what is called super-renormalizable. Sorry. This is super-renormalizable, so this can be renormalized. So at any parameters, you just have to fix G. Whereas the effective theory, of course, is not renormalized because there are all these higher units of operators. So the question is what happens beyond three levels. And of course, the other question which arises here, these things, this tree graph, as discussed before, are of course unit. They are real, therefore unitary bound.
So may I ask a question?
Yeah.
Am I allowed to ascribe physical meaning to the small s and m and large m at this point?
This is just the masses of the. So what I consider a light scalar field which has a small mass m. 1 MeV, and I consider a heavy mass, a heavy scalar with a mass capital M, say 1 GeV.
So in terms of nuclear physics, can that be like a pion and something heavy or something?
Sort of boson, but I mean,
okay.
It's just, if the proton describes a proton as a boson, it could be the pion as a proton.
Okay, that's what I was asking.
Like the pion in the row or something.
Can you do that at this point?
Yeah, all the pion in the row. If you
want. I mean, that's not exactly like the Rosa vector, but
So all the pion, like a pseudoscalar boson and some vector, which of course looks a bit different, but similar.
Yeah.
So let's look at this unitarity bound, and for the unitarity bound, it's useful to do this partial net expansion of the effective of the T matrix or the effective T matrix. And you know we can do this in terms of partial values, which are these TL, which are multiplied by the Jordan polynomials. This is a degenerous effect, and then this is just normalization. And you know that by unitary, imaginary part has to be bigger than P times the amplitude squared, and P is just the set of mass momentum S over 4 minus M squared. And the unitarity bound, the reverse is therefore it's a real part, because this is M squared plus V squared, has to be less than 1 over 2 P. This is just standard quantum mechanics. Now let's look at the S wave. So in the S wave, we can calculate this here, S wave is L equals 0. The real part of the tree level S wave amplitude is 24 C0 tilde, which is just this combination of C0 and C1, which you couldn't separate. And then 32 over 2 C2 times S over 4 M squared. This is just if you plug this combination S plus T plus 2 in the S wave, you get this essentially P squared squared. And now here's this unitarity bound. You look, this is a real part. You look at this relation, and you see this is saturated unitary bound at this value of S. It's 4 m squared, 16 pi minus 3 g tilde squared over this, where g tilde is just g over m. So this is defined so to make this coupling is finite as n goes to infinity. And you see that Sm is of order of the heavy mass squared, so of course there the effective fields is no longer applicable. We have said that we want this to work for energies or momenta which are of the small mass, but not of the large mass. And you see this unitary bound here is given by the large mass, so you need loops to restore this unitarity, because you cannot get to such energies. And therefore one says that the underlying theory, which is this, the full theory, provides an ultraviolet completion of the scales of the order m.
So is that effectively desensitizing you to the short-range part of the interaction? Is that effectively desensitizing this theory to the short-range part of the interaction?
Yeah. So here exactly you start to be sensitive to the large mass in short range, which you should not be anymore.
Okay.
And therefore you need loops to restore the unitarity. And now we can, the best thing to understand is just calculate the particle mass at one loop. And we do that in both theories. And then you can see how this EFT matching works. So the light particle mass at one loop in the full theory with the light and the heavy field is just this. You have this self-energy diagram, this Tadpole diagram. Again, this double red line, this, the heavy line is an RV particle, and the light line, black line, is a light particle. So there are two diagrams, this A and B. And again, you do this in dimensional regularization. So you go to G dimension and you put out factors of pi and I. So and then you can separate the poles because this thing is of course divergent, and you get this thing for the self energy, which depends on this L, which contains the divergence. Here's the number of space time dimension. Then you get other terms, which show you the coupling constant squared. The coupling constant comes in here, and you get logs of n squared over mu squared generalization scale in other terms. So that is the general result, which is expanded up to corrections order n to the minus 4. And of course, this is the result you can calculate in this full theory. Now we want to reproduce this result within the EFT, and that tells us how we have to treat the loops. So in the EFT, of course, we have only this type of loops. There's no more heavy field, the heavy field is integrated out, so we get this diagram I calculated before in the first lecture, with C0 insertion, C1 insertion, and so on. We get this tau of this so-called Tadpole diagrams. And this is our, if you want to calculate only to order 1 over capital M squared, you only use this term because this is already suppressed. If you use the equation of motion for the heavy fields. And then you see, you get essentially this calculation, the same calculation as before. And you get this expression here. And this is the effective L, because there's some other scale, because it's really effective. Not even this scale in the other calculation. You clearly see, if you compare this expression to the expression before, this is not the same. So you wonder, but of course, the full calculation is unequal to the effective piece of the calculation, but of course, you also must include mass and wave function normalization of this in the effective theory, which means this term, the d phi squared, gets renormalized, and also the mass term gets a renormalization. That you can calculate once you do this. You can calculate this just by standard techniques, and now you can compare the physical mass, and you can already see that you get new contributions which kind of remind you of the ones we've seen before. And the physical mass in the underlying theory is given by this equation, mass minus the physical mass minus the self energy is to the zero, because the mass is given by the pole and the propagator. And this is what you have in the denominator of the propagator. If you expand this in lowest order in G, you get this expression. The physical mass is the running mass of the function of mu plus these terms here. And the running mass is simply this expression. And in this order of the calculation, there are no regularizations of G and M. So this is the calculation in the full theory, in the effective theory, M squared plus B. This was this additional mass normalization factor, and then here's the wave function normalization, 1 plus A in physical mass minus the self energy squared is 0. So that's again the 0 of the denominator and the propagator. Expand in 1 over m squared, and you see you get this expression with a running effective mass, which again absorbs the infinities. And you can show now that this running mass, if you look at the scattering amplitudes, for example, are related to the physical observers are the same. So the masses look different, but the mass, of course, is running mass of an observer. You have to look at physical things like a scattering amplitude. And then you see that this is the same. You can work this out. And what is interesting is look at them as the running of these. So this is a running mass in the full theory, which has this constant term, and then disappears here. And this is a running mass in the effective theory, which is somewhat different. And you see, first of all, that this in the effective theory, the running mass does not depend on mu, which has to be because the observables. So the loops in general don't match, but the differences are taken away by normalization. So once you compare these now set in loops in the scattering amplitude in one loop, I show you the result in a moment, you see that they are the same. So these theories are physically equivalent, and this, of course, is called the decoupling theorem, because here you integrate out the heavy mass, and then you just see the inverse powers of this mass appearing. And you don't, in contrast to this mass, you have no logs of the effective light mass in this running. And this is a general phenomenon. If you have such a so-called decoupling EFT, the parameters of the EFT encode the short distance dynamics, like this one of M squared, and the light masses can only appear polynomial form. There cannot be any other functions of the light mass. And this becomes more clear if you now look at the scattering amplitude, because you want the T is T effective. So to one loop, so this is our tree-level graph now. In the full theory, you have this kind of a loop correction. So you get this graph, you get corrections, box plot, you get corrections, vertices, and so on. And for the effective theory, you have this loop, you have this randomization on the legs, which is this wave function randomization. You have this loop graph I showed you before. In the S and the T in the U channel. And then you, of course, support correction higher order counter terms. And if you do a lengthy calculation, you see that C0 has this funny form. So there's, of course, this diversion. Then there's a finite normalized piece. And so the normalized piece has this nice feature that the change of the coupling with respect to the mass is just given by the coupling itself squared. And then you can convince yourself, if you now plug in the masses you have calculated before, here and here you get really the same answer in the limit that the momenta in the scattering forces are of the order of the small mass and are much less than the big mass. So it's a bit tedious, but it's just worth to do the algebra. And such a form is interesting because it also appears in nuclear physics. So here you have this coupling constant of this C0 operators and C0 operators squared. And this is something which also discussed in nuclear physics. To lowest order, if you just don't have pi, just have nuclear interactions in nuclear scattering, you have a similar behavior. So the scale running of this operator is given by C0 times C0 minus 1, so similar to this. And this gives you a parabola curve like this. So there's so-called trivial infrared fixed point, which is here. This is both C0 equals 0, fulfills this equation. This is a natural case, and then you have another equation fulfilled, so there's another fixed point at C0 equal 1. And this is also a non-trivial fixed point, which defines the so-called unitarity limit. Come back to this in the end. But this is something where you see such a four-fermion interaction also at work. And of course, now you can go back up to our model theory, and we want to see how these couplings depend on the heavy mass. So at tree level, of course, it's very simple. As the mass, the heavy mass goes to infinity, the constant Ci go like g squared because the two couplings times mass to the power 2i plus 1, so it goes like n to 2i. So more and more powers of the heavy mass appear for the higher couplings. And naturalness means that these dimensionless couplings, which is Ci tilde, which is Ci times this power, should be order 1. Now, if you go beyond the tilde, you consider a typical loop graph like this with an injection of a Ci and Cj. This integral goes like Iij as these two constants in front. As dimensionless, you have to divide this out again, and then you have this such a nuclear, there are two propagators, m squared minus l squared m squared minus p, which is total momentum minus l squared, and some numerator function which depends on l and p. And this essentially is something like small m squared times the log m, so it doesn't depend on the heavy masses. So you can see that what is called an irrelevant coupling, which means it has an inverse mass dimension, stays irrelevant, so you don't get any enhancement here from this integral. So if this is 1 over m to the power, say, 20, this stays like the power m to the 20, and you can generalize this to higher loop graphs. So just doing these loops does not change the nature of the couplings. And so the important thing is that once you have done this naive estimate, that's all you need to know. So this is not modified by loop graphs. And this is also what you physically expect, but I mean, you still have to make sure that it's really the case. And now you can turn this into, this was the question asked before, this randomization group flow, this Wilsonian approach. So we can make some statements about the low energy effective theory just by seeing how this theory behaves when we change this cutoff in a certain range. So here we have this well scale separated theory, so M is much smaller than capital M. And also we have in between some cutoff, so that this holds that M is much smaller than this cutoff lambda, but this cutoff lambda itself is much smaller than the large mass M. So let's have some system like this. And now we want to vary lambda in some range. And this, of course, should leave the physics invariant at low energies. It should not matter where precisely I put this value of lambda. And this allows us to understand some issues in the effective field theory, which means the masses and couplings must also run accordingly. So for example, if you just phi 4 0 with one coupling C0, you get this dependence on this running mass. So m squared as a function of lambda is just the mass at the m squared as a capital mass, plus this integral in Euclidean space where you integrate from L to capital M, and then you integrate from L to lambda. So this is just going from, as this L drops out, so you just go from M to lambda. So that's just a fancy way of writing a 1. And you put, these are the two integrals we have done before. This is just this, you get M squared minus lambda squared minus this vox. And therefore, if you now differentiate with respect to lambda and multiply by lambda, you get again this behavior that you have C0 times lambda squared times correction of this. And these are called flow equations. So this tells you how the small mass changes with lambda when you vary lambda. The question is what we can read off from this. So you can also see that you generate all types of operators at lower scales, and the lower you get, the more operators you generate. And you might ask, this is the question, because then when you run your scale down, you start from a simple operator like 5-4-C, now you suddenly have complete other operators which appear here with rocks and whatever. But this is not a problem, because in fact the crucial statement, also made by Wilson, is that even if the series may look very different at the hard scales at lambda equal m, the difference vanishes when going to lower scales, lambda effective. And this you can easily understand. So take a model which has two coupling, one is marginal, one is irrelevant. So marginal means that this is just the coupling is just a number. Irrelevant means that the coupling is goes like an inverse power of the hard scale. So then these randomization group equations are lambda C0, lambda is just a beta function, which depends on C0 and lambda square C1, and lambda C1 over lambda is lambda to the minus 2, because the relevant coupling times beta 1 of these combinations. Now you rescale again, so C0 tilde C0 and C tilde 1 is lambda square C1 to have dimensionless couplings, and then you get these simple coupled equations for these running interaction strings. And of course, this doesn't tell you anything if you do not provide some initial values, because these are differential equations and you need initial values to solve them. So let's say we fix them at some point, we say we know the values at lambda equal to capital M, and we call them ci tilde 0 for I equal 0 and 1. This is our initial condition. And so we assume a solution at large lambda, and then we want to go to smaller lambdas. And if you can do the math, but it can be shown much nicer in the diagram, what happens, even though the theory looks very different at larger lambdas, when you follow these lines of solutions for the two equations, these are the upper and the lower line, you see that they slowly converge to one line. which means even though that here at large lambda series might look different, if you go to smaller lambdas, then they become the same. So you're only sensitive to one of these parameters, so in this case it's zero. So the physics at the large scale gets decoupled from the one at the low scale. So even though, as I said, that here there's difference theory, once you run down to some smaller cutoff, this difference gets smaller and smaller, and you essentially end up with one unique theory. And this is something which has been used long before by Deschen and Neuwing and other people to derive a bound on the Higgs mass, which is the so-called triviality bound. And this goes like followings. So the beta, so the, there was this beta function, which you're not familiar with this. So this function here in the running will call the beta function. So lambda dc0 to lambda, this is called the beta function of this operator. And this is the beta function of that operator. This determines the running. So if you have your theory where your beta function is strictly positive in growth like this, so here's some momentum or whatever, some variable beta of x that just grows, faster than a linear function, this is faster than linear, then the Berg coupling the mass goes to infinity, this Berg coupling must vanish. So this Berg coupling is the C0m, so Sm goes to infinity, sorry. The cutoff can only be removed if the theory becomes trivial, so this thing has to vanish. And this is used in the standard model in the Higgs sector. The Higgs sector of the standard model is this nucleate of boson fields, which has a kinetic term, a mass term, and this itself interaction, just from this wide body potential, you know this. And the running for the C0 of the self interaction has just this form. One of C0 of lambda is C0 of m plus this you get from the one loop running we just calculated, and this has to be larger than of course this because this goes to zero. And then you use the tree-level relations, you can show that the Higgs mass over the W mass is given by this divided by G square. And therefore you can derive, you plug this in here, you get a bound on the Higgs mass in Higgs over the W is less than this number. These numbers you can calculate to 900 GeV divided by the W mass times the log, which means that the Higgs mass has to be less than 900 GeV. So this is one of these nice applications because you can show that if the theory becomes trivial, so it's no more coupling at large masses, then you can get bounds on these coupling constants and then you can turn, for example, the standard world into a coupling of the Higgs mass here. This has been used long term. Of course, you can refine this. You get something like 500 GeV or 400 GeV, some other numbers to refine this, but that's what you refine this. So now the point is, this was all what is called decoupling EFTs, which have been analyzed by Applequist and Carazone in the mid-70s first in detail. So in this model which I discussed, the effects of the heavy fields are power suppressed or appear only in the normalization of the light. You have seen that all these operators had like 1 over m squared, 1 over m fourth, or there were some implicit dependence in the coupling constants of the heavy field. And that's called decoupling EFT, so that because when the mass of the heavy fields is m heavy, or the capital M becomes to infinity, the heavy fields decouple and the shifts become unobservable. So this means that all these operators which go like powers of 1 over m become zero, and the shifts in the coupling constant again become unobservable because they also go to zero. So that's what's called decoupling EFT. As the large mass goes to infinity, there's a complete decoupling of the heavy theory, you cannot observe it anymore. And this renormalization group flows and renormalization group equations in general are a powerful tool to analyze these decoupling EFTs because we have seen that we can use this to see, even though we have difference in the series at large lambdas, we can run this down to smaller lambdas and then see that we get a unique EFT. And there are a few examples of this. For example, this Euler-Heisenberg slash Coppel-Lagrangian is such a decoupling EFT for energies much less than the electron mass. There you can really show that, in fact, this happens when you let the electron mass go to infinity, all these heavy mass effects decouple completely, you just see plain photon effects. And so this is one example. Then the weak interactions at energy is much less than W mass, so the four Fermi Lagrangian is of a similar type. Again, if you let the mass of the W become infinite, heavy, all this stuff decouples and you're just left with the plane for Fermion interaction. And also the standard model, so the electrovec theory of quantum coordinate for strange strong interactions, and SO2 left was to one hypercharge for the combined electrovec interaction below 1 TeV is such a decoupling EFT. So then all the heavy degrees of freedom are power suppressed, which come from possibly higher extension of this model or become unabsorbed in the shifts. So any EFT you write down for the standard model has operators which go like 1/heavy mass to some power, and this is inverse power of this heavy mass. So that's one class, and this was the class of series which was discussed in this model. Because in this model, the heavy mass really has this decoupling behavior that the heavy fields are power suppressed or appear on this randomization. The couplings, if you looked at this function I wrote down for you, G is a function of smaller than capital N, and in the limit that the heavy mass goes to peak, all this goes away. So that this model was one example, simple example for such a decoupling EFT. But there's also another class of EFTs which are so-called non-decoupling EFTs. And these are the ones I will discuss in the next lectures tomorrow. So these are somewhat more tricky because what happens there during the transition from the underlying to the effective Lagrangian, some phase transition happens, right? There's potential symmetry breaking and generating particles, say Goldstone bosons or pseudo Goldstone bosons, by symmetry breaking, with a mass which is much less than the typical scale of symmetry breaking. So it's like you have some effective theory where you don't just simply integrate your heavy field, but you get new, if you go to some phase transition, you suddenly generate some new light fields. This is another possibility. So that is described like you do this in QCD kind dynamics later. So that's another thing which is non-decoupling EFT. So you have some kind of phase transition, and when you go from the high energies to the low energies, and then in this phase transition, new light degrees of freedom are generated. So then, of course, there's a difference between the series we discussed before. And the symmetry breaking, of course, entails relation between matrix and this different number of Goldstone bosons. So this, for this canonical dimension, less or bigger or less than 4, becomes really meaningless. Because you have relations between 2, 4, 6, and 8 pions, for example, in the symmetry breaking. And, you know, for example, a pion field as a boson field is canonical dimension. Once you get relation between 2, 4, 6, 8, it's many pions. And therefore, it makes no more sense to discuss even this in terms of generalization of the irrealizable theory. So that L effective is intrinsically non-irrealizable just by the construction. And there are two very famous examples. So there's, of course, a standard model without Higgs. You don't need the Higgs, but then the Goldstone bosons are the longitudinal components of the vector bosons, which is just eaten by the Higgs mechanism. And the one which I will discuss is a standard model below the chiral symmetry breaking scale. So I explain this in more detail in the next lecture. QCD has this chiral symmetry, which is a symmetry between light quarks that you can write them in left and right handed components which are non interacting. And this is called chiral symmetry for the standard in deep term. And this chiral symmetry entails certain properties. However, we know that these properties are not respected by the vacuum. In fact, the vacuum has lesser symmetry, and this is called symmetry breaking. So the full symmetry group is broken down to some smaller subgroup, and with a breaking, masses or light particles appear, and these are the pions of QCD. And this is a typical example for such a case. You have a phase transition, and then you get new light degrees of freedom, and the effective field theory is essentially written in terms of this new phase transition to the particle. And this is QCD chiral dynamics, which I will discuss in the next lectures in detail. And I think with this lecture I'm done, so I don't want to start this, so maybe we ask more questions here.
So I, as much as I tried to resist it, I was found myself translating back to kind of phenomenological nucleon-nucleon models. And that's probably not appropriate, but so one of the ways that this kind of pseudo-field theory models handled dealing with different ranges of the different distance scales was to have different mass exchange particles.
Yep.
And I guess multiple loop exchange. How does this formalism deal with the different ranges? Is it through the loops?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. So for the moment, I've really discussed this very simple things where you have this light scale and the heavy scale. But of course, you can also imagine, and that is relevant to the nuclear case, where it's 1 pi chase, 2 pi chase in shorter wave physics, that you have like various layers. So you have an EFT for very low energies, which has certain degrees of freedom, then you go to somewhat more resolution, then you have another EFT which you match to the one. In fact, it will do it in the lecture. So it's a whole layer of EFTs which depend on the resolution you look. So it's for example, in nuclear low energies, I showed you don't need pi, it's just low energy for nuclear interaction. But once you start to resolve it more, then you have to have pion exchange, and so then you resolve more of the structure of the interaction and so on and so forth. So you can do this in layered steps, so to speak. So you don't have just one separation, but you can have series of separations. So that would be this, that you match one EFT to another, which gets progressively more complicated. This is, for example, what you also do in the standard model. You integrate all the Ws, and then you go to the integral to the heavy quarks, and then you go to the light quarks. It's a multi-step phenomenon. But this is just too complicated for these vectors. It's just, in principle, it's clear. You just repeat this at various levels. And then you of course, also at each level, you have to match a physical observable so that you have the information kind of correct going from the higher to the lower energies. So you just do this a couple of times instead of once. And then you can build up some more multi-scale physics in your problem and different ranges of resolution.
So for low energy stuff, you don't have to pay the tax for higher resolution than you need.
Yeah, the point is always that you, that depends again on the system. So if you have a very simple system, which you want to only understand some bulk properties, not too detailed, then you can work with a simple EFT, everything gets integrated out. Once you, like the Hochberg expansion I showed at the beginning, once you start to want to resolve this more, then you have to take higher order operations and eventually you have to change the EFT, that you have to take more degrees of freedom into account. So for example, in the nuclear case, if you really work at extremely low energies, you just need this contact interaction. You don't need the pions, because they don't contribute that much. But as soon as you go to some 50 or some other scale, and you start to see the pions, of course you have to include the pions in the EFT, then you get somewhat more complicated things that you have pion exchange plus contact term. And this depends always on what the systems you're looking at and what are the questions you want to ask and which resolution you want to look at.
They have to reflect on it.
Well, I believe they've already gotten 3 problems assigned to them, right?
That's true, yeah.
So.
There are a couple of problems assigned. Right? Okay, maybe I make a big commercial. Tomorrow things become easier because tomorrow life goes back to the real life. Let me just go to the first page. Okay, tomorrow we want to do the following. So I told you already in words that in the of this pion symmetry in the dynamics, so there's a symmetry breaking which generates this pion. So I will discuss this Goldstein mechanism in a very simple way that you can see that if you have a symmetry breaking, there are massless particles, and how that symmetry can be mapped onto an effective field theory of pions. Also bosons, pions, kaons, and etas in the SO3 case, and how you can set this up. So I will just essentially show you how you construct such an EFT for Goldstein bosons. And you can easily then make nice relations, say, between the masses of the quarks, which are the symmetry breaking terms, and the underlying Lagrangian, the masses of the Goldstein boson, which are the particles relating to the Kyle symmetry breaking. And then the typos and then one set of reactions you've seen that many times already. Now it's just a scattering, elastic scattering of particles, which are really, if you, some of the first tests of these EFTs. So like if you look at pion scattering, pion kaon, pion nucleon, kaon nucleon, and also Bose-Bose scattering of p-mesons. And one interesting thing which I will discuss in this context is also effective fields with abundances. So far, I've only looked at scattering scales. I've looked at two-party scattering in the mass function or so on. But of course, things become a bit more interesting if you have bound states. And one way which is very nice to get hadron and hadron scattering is these molecules of hadrons. So you have, for example, ionic hydrogen wave instead of using electron, you use a negatively charged ion to be bound with a photon. So you have a Coulomb problem with a bit of strong interactions because the Bohr radius of the system is very large compared to the strong interaction radius. And then you can calculate the strong interaction in perturbation theory. And that gives you a very precise determination of the scattering amplitude at zero momentum transfer, or very small momentum transfer. So for that, of course, you have to develop this bound state EFT, which is a bit more intricate. But this is very nice because you can really make high precision determinations of scattering parameters in such bound systems, say of a pion at a proton or K minus in the proton or a pion in a deuteron, where you substitute electrons also by pions.
Okay. All right, well, thank you very much.